today we're going to be introducing a new concept called field-driven design, which we're excited to talk about. Here's a quick rundown of today's presenters and our agenda. So my name is John Graham. I'm the product marketing manager at nTopology, and I'll give you a little background on nTopology and the subject we're talking about today. And then our lead application engineer, Jonathan Harris, will be walking you through this field-driven design concept and showing you many examples and illustrating the usefulness of it and really how simple yet powerful it is. Let's step back and talk a little about nTopology as a whole and the position and what our company is doing, our vision, and how we're helping enterprise organizations in the engineering space. nTopology is a rapidly growing software company making design engineering solutions for advanced manufacturing. We started in 2015. We're based in New York City, and we have this goal of creating a better product development system that's driven by data and physics. Now, that word data is important. It's everywhere. Some may say that we have too much data in this day and age floating all around us, but I would argue that we don't really have a full grasp on how to best handle it. Now, this really gets into our mission. Our mission is helping engineers better define, represent, and lock down various engineering processes, information digitally, through our software applications so that they can be configured and repurposed and reused for tomorrow's products. And we accomplish this in a couple ways. One of the major ways is by combining elements of design, engineering, simulation, and advanced manufacturing in this digital process that makes engineering knowledge usable by other engineers in an organization. And if you think about it, that common thread through these three functions I just mentioned, design, simulation, and advanced manufacturing outputs, it's data. The accurate and efficient flow of data is so critical for product development. And so that's why we as a company exist, promoting our data environment system that enables a smarter and more efficient design process. Now, that's a little of who we are and what our mission and vision is and what we've set out to do. Regarding our products, if you've seen nTop software in action before in a session like this or in a demonstration or on the web, there's a good chance you saw nTop Element, which enables engineers to easily create optimized lattice structures for additive manufacturing. Now, Element is an excellent tool for what it does. Since the creation of it, we've expanded our scope and our sphere of influence to look and take our learned knowledge to create something called nTop Platform, which is really a computational engineering environment for the three things I mentioned earlier: design, simulation, and advanced manufacturing processes. It's the only design solution out there that allows an engineer to simultaneously consider function, geometry, and manufacturing processes within a computational framework. Now, what do I mean by computational? Well, it really boils down to control. You have a robust environment where everything you choose to model and capture is done so in this transparent manner. There's no black box designs for which you have no control. Now, nTop Platform is probably best described in three ways as it relates to the intended goals and the benefits that it gives enterprise organizations and its end users. High performance geometry, regardless of the complexity of the product or the part in which you're working. The second would be connected engineering systems. So I've mentioned that a few times, connecting the functions of design, simulation, and manufacturing, and those disciplines all in an integrated environment. And then finally, capturing engineering workflows. So making sure that all the knowledge, all the process information is not just captured, but is repurposed for future products in an efficient way. Now, these are all broad topics, and we're excited to be unpacking all of these in the future. Today, as I mentioned, we're talking about this new concept called field-driven design, which really directly ties into that second benefit of nTop Platform, connected systems. It benefits all of them, or ties into all of them, but mostly the connected engineering systems. Now, before I turn things over to Jonathan, I want to, at a high level, explain field-driven design and what it's all about. Field-driven design is a way of capturing the defining shape, physics, and manufacturing processes in a single unified environment using scalar or vector information. Now, fields are actually everywhere in the work we do and the modeling that we have, but they haven't really been utilized in a way that nTopology is using them in nTop Platform. And so field-driven design is really a method of approaching the entire design process with the language of fields driving the consumed data and therefore the processes. Now again, Jonathan is going to get into the what and the hows and the where, but as far as the benefits and the why of using fields, let me try to unpack that a little bit. And there's probably many more benefits than we have time to discuss, but I want to focus on just three of them at the moment. And the first one is really that using fields and using them particularly in nTop platform is really a platform for the knowledge sharing. Now, as I stated earlier, design, simulation, and manufacturing knowledge can be collected, overlaid, and synthesized into a model so all disciplines and all stakeholders can have their input. And so this ensures the best designs are possible. The second is it also translates into improved collaboration. Processes need not be in this serial fashion as they have done for so many years and for so long. There's really not a throw it over the wall concept when you're using fields, meaning design need not do their work, throw it over to simulation and wait a long time. In this collaborative environment where simulation data, for example, can work in real time with the design process, and manufacturing can also have input and a say as to how something should be built in the processes, that can all be done in this environment. So as a result, you get to the third one, and that's more trade studies or faster trade studies and more design iteration loops. So behind all this is implicit modeling, which allows for the use of fields to drive data, which better incorporates simulation and empirical data and manufacturing process knowledge into design. So as a result of an improved overall process, more feasibility or trade studies can be done faster and more in a shorter amount of time. Now here's a simple example of how all of this may play itself out. If you look at this example of a quadcopter, a design space is defined, complete with the intended material and boundary conditions. And this is really just a field of data, maybe something binary, where yes, there needs to be material, or no, there does not. Next, some kind of a generative process, such as topology optimization, could be used to identify probable load paths or stress concentrations. Again, it's a field of data that's not binary in this case, but it's scalar. You may have a field of loads or stress values at all the locations set out in your envelope or in your initial space. Converting all of that information to the implicit format is what we do in nTop platform. And that's really a topic, an informational session in and of itself, maybe a future one that we'll do. And this allows for future operations, one of which may be the ability to overlay that scalar data of stresses into the geometry model, alter the material at a cellular level, and intelligently vary the density based on where the material is actually needed. And this is really a very smart or intelligent design process. Putting material where it actually is needed and using data, a lot of data, simulation data in this case, or maybe empirical data to back that up. And we can't forget about the manufacturing data. If this quadcopter were to be metal additive manufactured, for example, a very specific laser tool path is needed. Now, this isn't an exhaustive list by any means, but things like the power of the laser beam, the rate of travel, the interval between layers and contours, the spacing between hatching, etc., all of these things will have an impact on the final design, and all can be represented as fields and utilized in an environment like nTop platform. I'm going to turn things over to Jonathan now, who's going to put some better pictures and examples to everything I just said. Jonathan, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you, John. So I'm Jonathan Harris, lead application engineer at nTopology, and I will go through fields in a little more detail and show you them through our software. So an octet lattice like this can be stored as hundreds of beam elements, thousands of surface patches and edges, millions of triangles in an STL format, or as one implicit field. What this brings is not only a lightweight storage mechanism, but also the ability to do some pretty unique things to strengthen the lattice. So there's been some research into using nodal fillets in the lattices to reduce stress concentrations and increase the buckling resistance of the struts. And that's, people have found this can boost strength and stiffness up to 20% in an octet. So this is quite an attractive capability, but you simply can't do it with the BREP model. Imagine clicking these edges, which is quite a complicated intersection, selecting all the edges in your model. In this case, it's just a small specimen. In some of our parts that we see come across our desk, there could be millions of unit cells. There's simply no way of filleting all those edges unless you're using an implicit representation, which makes it a little easier. So here we can see some fillets appear. All we're doing there is relaxing the field in that area, which you can see in this close-up here. So along on the right, we have an octet with nodal fillets. On the left, we have a normal octet lattice. You can see the difference in the field, which emanates from this part, almost like waves in a pond. You can see how there's smoother contours with the nodal fillets. Since our geometry representation is exactly what you see in this blue image, this field, all we're doing to achieve that is smoothening these contours. So there's no clicking edges and trying to get a fillet radius. We're just doing math under the hood to get this really high performance geometry. Okay, let me show you this in our software. So say we had a plate which we want to have some perforations in. It's quite simple to put a uniform perforation pattern into a plate, but what if you wanted to grade that pattern from one edge to the other? So with a field representation, that's very easy to do. What we do here is we grade our hole size along the field of any object that we drop in. So in this case, I'm just grading it along this this linear map here, this plane, but it's equally as simple to grade it along something like this plane. So I'm going to drop this one in and you'll see how that changes. Okay, so now this is this perforation pattern is being controlled from this central axis, and we can of course change the range of that field modifier, the size distribution, the function which it spans across, and its continuity, whether it's a linear ramp, whether it's a cubic ramp, or whatever function you want to define. You can see that we can drag in this case, I'm going to show with a hollow cylinder here how that looks. So we'll make a ramp which transfers our implicit field from this geometry of a hollow cylinder into the perforation pattern of our plate. So here we go. And so now you can see that distance field from the cylinder controls the perforation pattern of our plate, and we can switch that around so that the holes are closer to the cylinder. Okay, so that's using a geometry field. What if I had a field from a simulation result? So in this case, I have a quick simulation setup of a vibrating plate. This could be a thermal simulation, this could be an impact simulation, it could be done in our software, or it could be imported from another CAE package of your choosing. What we can do here is relate those stress values, relate those displacement values, those thermal values into a geometry modifier. So what I'm gonna do is drag in our simulation field, which you saw with this heat map. I'm going to control our geometry. How about we do a little more interesting mode here? I'm going to drag this one in. And we'll let that run. And you can see that perforation pattern is now controlled by my simulation result. Maybe you want to use that to control the flow rate through plenum, or maybe you want to use that to grade stiffness according to some stress result. The choice is up to you. So in a similar example, we can do this on not just hole size, but with this same simulation field, we can show it to control our lattice spacing. So in this case, I'm going to generate a stochastic foam here, and we're going to see that I relate that simulation field to the spacing or the pore size of our stochastic foam. So simulation field here, varying pore size of a stochastic over here. And just to, out of curiosity, let's see. So we got, we generated 1.1 million beams according to this functionally graded pattern in just about 5 or 6 seconds. So with this field approach, we can make some pretty complicated structures very quickly. And again, how about we switch the mode over to something more exciting? And there you have it. So you can drag in simulation results, you can link them to an external solver, and you can drive your geometry directly in nTop. So another example of this in action could be with a beam in bending. So I have a few load cases set up here. I'm just going to run this quick cantilever beam simulation. You can see displacement there. Let's just take a quick look at the stress. So the stress pattern that you'd expect to see in a cantilever beam, we can now use that information gathered from the simulation to drive our microstructure of our lattice. So I had this lattice in the background in this sandwich configuration, and I'm using that field to thicken the lattice struts where material's needed and thin them out where it's not. And so that was linked to a cantilever beam case. If we want to show the speed here, we can switch it over to, say, a three-point bend. And let's see how that goes. So here's the stress field that you'd expect. And you can see that stress field is transferred into our geometry through this implicit representation. So one last example in the software is maybe with a field that's a little more exotic. I have this defined manually, this field, to be this this wave. And I'm going to use this to show that we can really drive geometry with any sort of field. So I have a stochastic foam here, and you can see the pore size is graded along our geometry modifier here. So anywhere in this orange section, we get high density, and then I have a linear drop off from that field. And again, just to show scalability, we have 1.2 million beams in looks like 8 seconds or so. So this field, maybe you could use something like this to direct thermal conductivity through a part. Maybe you could use it to channel flows while keeping the whole structure open cell. You could, of course, use it for stress shielding in a medical application where you might want a graded mechanical properties across your part. Really, the use of fields in driving geometry and engineering parts really unlocks a whole new realm of geometric capability and design spaces. So one might think maybe on a turbine blade you could drive the perforation pattern based on maybe an imported CFD thermal analysis result. Maybe you could drive it based on some empirical data gathered from a test in the field, and you could put those holes and size them according to where extra cooling is needed. Maybe in a lattice, you could use that field to compensate for edge effects and thicken the struts locally where material is needed. any sort of simulation result, any sort of empirical result, frankly, any sort of data can be represented as a field in nTop platform and then used to drive geometry. So it's quite a novel approach to engineering and unlocks a lot of new capabilities. So with that, I'll hand it back to John and we can take a few questions.
Thank you for that, Jonathan. That was very informative and exciting to watch. Let's talk about some next steps before we go into the question and answer time. If any of you have seen this content today and are curious to learn a bit more, please shoot us an email at sales@nTopology.com. We can set you up with a personalized demonstration and talk about some next steps about integrating this type of technology into your workflows. Also, please do check out our blog, nTopology.com/blog. We did have a recent one that our VP of product, Blake Quarter, put out on this very topic of field-driven design. So if you want to get an additional perspective, I encourage you to go and read that. There'll also be a link at the bottom of the blog to be able to stream this informational session very soon. And finally, keep checking out our website or your email as we have future announcements about these informational sessions. We'll be doing them about once every month or so, give or take. Let's talk about some of the questions that you all have been asking, and we'll go to those now. Jonathan, maybe you want to tackle a few of these. Let me shout them out to you, if you don't mind. First question we're getting is, can I manually construct my field if I know them but don't have them as a simulation output?
So yes, you can model a field from points. You can model it from any geometry, like I showed with those curves. You could model it from vector fields, whether you write these in nTop or you import them from MATLAB. Anything, any data you can represent as a field, and then just choose your units of choice or convert those units to a geometric space. For example, a simulation result in megapascals, you would just be writing a transfer from megapascals to millimeters to drive your part, say, thickness or offsets. Yeah.
All right, thank you for that. The next question is, can I combine fields from different physics?
Yes, definitely. So you can combine them. You could combine the results of a thermal conductivity analysis and a stress analysis. The way that you would do that would just be you have to convert the units. So you could take your thermal conductivity, transfer that to millimeters, through some relation. You could take your stress analysis and convert that to length units. So you'd have something like a transfer function from megapascals to millimeters, and you can define that function, whether it's a linear mapping, whether it's some exponential mapping. You can write whatever function you want to drive the geometry through any sort of field. Now, combining them, you just add them. That's it. You get the units in the right spot and you add them. You can do a weighted average too. Actually, we have a slide to show on that. You can see in this slide, there's a three-point bend, a cantilever beam, and I've combined those to have a weighted average of those two fields. So there's nothing stopping you from having one of those fields being from totally different physics. You would just have to use your engineering knowledge to convert those appropriately into a geometry driver. Because at the end of the day, the stress, the thermals, the acoustics, whatever physics you're modeling, it's the same format as our geometry, which is an implicit field.
Okay, great. And next question is, what happens if my field has singularities? For example, what about noisy data?
So sometimes singularities are nice ways to define fields, especially in fluid mechanics, but they're not so great for creating geometry. The way we can overcome that is we simply clamp them. So say you have a sink in a field, you can just clamp it so that minus infinity is just capped at, say, minus 10 or whatever value you want. Noisy data is really easy to handle because we can smoothen it very quickly. This will actually be... We'll show this off a little bit more. We can show it to you in a demo if you want to arrange that. We can show you that we can smooth noisy data very quickly in our implicit kernel, taking complicated simulation meshes and converting them to smooth implicits in a few seconds. So that's actually one of our key strengths there.
All right, thank you for that. And the final question is, how is this better than mates and relations in normal CAD?
So mates and relations in CAD, they're great for parts which don't change that much. If you make radical design changes, say your part becomes, it changes from a rectangular prism to a torus, something crazy like that, I can almost guarantee you the geometry will not rebuild successfully. Say you have a perforation pattern on those parts. No way. With implicit fields, it doesn't really care about what the geometry is because it's all represented as one field. So if you have a modifier field, like in that perforation example, I had a few. One was an axis, one was a linear ramp, one was from simulation. What that field is influencing doesn't actually really matter because it's just a mathematical operation. There's no edges to keep track of. There's no points to be keeping track of to keep things watertight. There's just math going on behind the scenes, and you get geometry which rebuilds every time, which is functionally graded down to whatever control precision you want.
Okay, thank you for that, Jonathan. We appreciate it. That's about all the time we have and all the questions we'll go through. So thank you all for coming again, and please stay tuned for future informational sessions. Have a great day.